your dogs and cats. First, self-pet general well-being. It enhances the vitality and the energy of your pet. It also enhances the texture and sheen of the coat of your animal. It also helps in the urinary function and also the detoxifying function when the liver is fighting with other diseases. Self-pet female. It provides vitality and nutrition during pregnancy and during lactation. It provides additional calcium to the lactating bitches. Self-pet immune booster. It takes care of the immunity-related diseases of your pets and it also increases the vitality of the immune system, especially after taking the antibiotics. Self-pet Junior. It is suitable for all puppies and kittens from 7 weeks onwards. It supports the skeletal development during early years. It improves digestion and it also reduces the unbalanced hyperactivity of all the puppies.
हेलो
नमस्कार मिस्टर मोहित आर यू लिसनिंग डॉक्टर विजय लक्ष्मी या थैंक यू सो मच मैम डॉक्टर राममूर्ति
गुड आफ्टरनून सर
थैंक यू सर गुड आफ्टरनून वेरी गुड आफ्टरनून नमस्कार मैम फॉर Ma'am is not coming on the screen.
Yeah.
Mr. Mohit, are you listening?
Yeah, I'm listening to you. Yes.
Thank you. Namaskar. Please, we are not seeing the Dr. Vijay Lakshmi, ma'am.
No, she was here only. Let me.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm here.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, welcome, ma'am.
I'm okay. Here. Yeah, welcome.
Ma'am, very warm. Welcome. Ma'am, you have become the host, ma'am.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Hello. Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, we can hear you, ma'am. Very well.
Yeah. So I have become the host and I can screen share. Can, right?
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Okay. That's good.
So, ma'am, can I introduce you, ma'am? Can I introduce you on?
Yeah, definitely.
Yes, ma'am, sure.
Yeah, definitely.
So, ma'am, hello everyone. So, this is Mohit Gupta. I'm the CEO in Enchantrix Organic Private Limited. We are representing Selpet, Celotine, and many ophthalmic
patients
and giving to all the veterinarians. We're very happy to introduce Dr. Lakshmi Vijay. She's a professor and head department of veterinary medicine in Pondicherry College, Veterinary College. Happy webinar. It's a sepsis in dogs. And Dr. Ramamurthy, the founder and admin of VetLife. Thank you, Dr. Ramamurthy. Thank you so much. And Dr. Sanjeev Nehru, it is possible for this webinar today. Doctor, it's a organizing in organizer Havan. Thank you. So go to Dr. Vijay Ram, please.
Yeah, thank you everybody.
Yeah.
Before going into the subject of today's discussion, I would like to first thank my dean, Dr. Ram Kumar, the dean of the Rajiv Gandhi Institute of Veterinary Education and Research, located in Puducherry. So first, I should, because of his constant support and encouragement, probably we are at this stage here. Anyway, he had made some discussions with Dr. Ramamurthy sir regarding the webinar program from our college, from one of the hosts from our college. So he also was very much keen on and showed his interest of giving me a slot in his webinar in VetLife, an international organization. That's how I am over here. But otherwise, you know, it's quite difficult for me to make it up. So this is, first of all, I should thank my dean first. Then all the organizers, Dr. Sajid Nehru, Dr. Mr. Mohit Gupta, and especially my special thanks to Ramamurthy sir, who has made all this possible. Okay, thank you so much, Dr. Ramamurthy sir, and Mohit Gupta, and Sajid Nehru sir. And coming to the next thing of your today's presentation, actually, this is the sepsis in dogs. In India, it's actually in a very primitive state. Actually, we have not been a lot of research on that. Although we are seeing day to day a lot of cases related to sepsis. Probably I will be showing a lot of case discussions. You may try to understand that so many cases are being there with sepsis. So let us make a beginning for the sepsis as on data. Very few research has gone undertaking, I mean, they have started with the Madras Veterinary College also. Actually, when I was first doing my PhD program, I was little interested with sepsis. So what I did is, I actually made a presentation on sepsis for my credit seminar. That's how I made some little interest on that. And it was a very, for the academicians, it was a little elaborate and all that. Okay. And then it started like that. Then after that, they had made some research also. Then IVRA also started research on sepsis in dogs. So this is the beginning of the sepsis, we can see. So this is this particular presentation is mainly useful for the practitioners actually. Can you hear me? Hello.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Shall I proceed? So this is only in the beginning stage, and this particular presentation is very practical aspect of sepsis. Practical aspect of sepsis in dogs. It is not very for the academicians. It's for the practitioners, for the beginners, for the budding veterinarians. So I will give some keynote on this particular sepsis on today's program. Okay, this is something to start for this today's presentation. Shall I go about presenting, or shall we wait for some time? Shall we wait for some time, or shall we go? Shall we proceed? Shall I screen share? Because there are only few participants. I could see only 135 or so participants. I will just wait for some time also. There's no issue about it. And sepsis, of course, in dogs. It's totally been very common among our day-to-day practice. Probably we see sepsis in the early stage. We see in the severe sepsis forms or late stage or sometimes septic shock also. So how to understand sepsis in a very easy form? What are the cytokines? How it is going to trigger this immune mechanism, and how would the animal is ending in sepsis? All that can be well seen in today's thing. Shall I go for a screen share? Share screen. I will go for a share screen. Okay.
Hello.
Hello.
Participating is are increasing, ma'am.
Yeah.
So every minute they are increasing the participant.
Okay.
I think if we can wait for the 5 minutes more, though, so we can participate on the 200 to more than 200 participants. Sir.
Definitely, so, sir. We will wait for some time. Wait for some time. There's no issue. There's already a lot of time there, so we will wait for some time.
Yeah. In the meantime, you can change with the Mr. Mohit. You can start with the CellPet.
Yeah.
Mr. Mohit.
I can listen to you, sir. I can listen to you. Thank you so much.
You can start with the CellPet, your advertisement. So we can wait for already, the 5 to 10 minutes.
He has already made it. The advertisement is already made. And he has already completed it also. Self-Pet Products. He has already completed the video. He has made a video on that. And put the useful information on that also. Let's wait for some time. It's not at all an issue. And everywhere we get a lot of practice on dogs. So sepsis is a very common problem. So let's see something about it.
Doctor, you can talk something about liver.
Ramurthy sir is saying right. You tell me about ma'am.
Rajiv Gandhi Institute of Veterinary Education and Research. So this is located in Pondicherry. It's almost some around 6 to 7 kilometers from the main place, and in we have an efficient dean, Dr. Ram Kumar, and we have got around 17 departments in our college. And we have a teaching veterinary clinical complex located a little away from the college, actually. It is located in a place called as Metapalayam. And we have four different departments in the teaching veterinary clinical complex. We have the surgery unit, medicine unit, then gynecology, and we have a VCC also, veterinary clinical complex unit. We get a lot of cases in the clinical campus, almost around some 50 dogs in the medicine unit, 40 to 50 dogs we should get in the medicine unit, and sometimes in surgery we get around 10 to 15 cases or 20 cases, and gynecology.
Ma'am, can you do one thing, one favor of me? Most of the veterinarians want to have gynecological chapters also in the biometra of in females. Okay. So can we plan for the next week for the biometra?
Definitely, we'll try to do it, sir. Because I have to speak with the vet over there in the gynecology department. We will finalize it. Probably, I will speak to the dean also. Dr. Ramamurthy sir can also share his views with Dr. Ram Kumar, Dean Diga. I think it's possible also. But anyway, in the sepsis case, because it's a very common cause of sepsis dogs, I'm sharing a video on pyometra also. A very little information on pyometra. It's not exactly, I'm not going deep about the pyometra case, but very little about the pyometra.
Thank you.
Doctor, we have crossed 2020. Sorry, 220.
Yes.
We can proceed.
Yes.
Participants have crossed 2022.
Doctor Sanjeev Agarwal.
Yeah.
Thank you. Namaskar. Welcome.
Namaskar. Thank you.
Thank you. Welcome. Welcome.
Good afternoon.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am, you can start, ma'am, now.
Okay.
Now that the gathering is increasing day by day, every minute.
But, ma'am, they're 2:30, ma'am. 2:30 parts.
Okay, shall we start?
They're increasing, ma'am.
Okay, let them come. Okay. But otherwise, from the beginning, if they see, then they will have some good idea. Otherwise, once they come in between, probably not be so clear about the topic. Let's wait for 5 minutes. We will wait.
5 minutes more.
Thank you, ma'am. It will be right, ma'am.
Yeah. So we in India, usually the major problem is the tick-borne infectious diseases. So also these type of infectious diseases, the protozoan diseases, the rickettsial and the viral diseases, also very common everywhere. And the most important tick-borne diseases are mainly the babesiosis. So this is my important topic of interest during my PhD program. So I pursued my PhD from Madras Veterinary College. And this Babesia gibsoni is causing too much of problem in our practice. And Babesia gibsoni and Babesia canis, of course, Babesia canis also. Sepsis also occurs in these type of disease. apart from that Hello.
सुको म्यूट करना है
क्रास अंत क्रास का इमेजिंग वस्तुन अंत वेरा वेरा वाले वस्तुन
है
इसी को नहीं ऑन करा इन्होंने बोले जल्दी जल्दी फ्री करके फ्री कर दे सबको
डॉक्टर विजयलक्ष्मी मैम mute all the participants except you.
Gupta, please mute all the participants.
Yes, ma'am. Because there's a lot of noise.
Yes. Sir, you just write down the hello to this number, okay? Hello to hi कर दीजिए सर मुझे just hi to me. I will send you the password and ID. Right sir, just right.
Doctor Vijayashmi, start.
Yeah.
manage participants and mute all.
Shall we start, sir?
Yes, you can go, madam.
Yeah, we can talk about it.
So, ma'am, you are the host now, ma'am. So,
okay.
Yes, ma'am. So, everyone, they mute, ma'am. So,
it's already muted, you know?
Okay. Yeah, you can start now.
No, host disabled participant screen sharing is given. You make me as a host. Just you make me as a host. It's done.
You are the host, ma'am. Yes. Yes, ma'am.
No, it's been disabled. It's given as disabled. Screen sharing disabled.
Okay, just hold on.
Just able it, you know. Just screen share able it.
My call is it my back so I don't.
Hey, what is the receiver? She's a
you're the host, ma'am.
Host.
Just hold on.
No, it is disabled.
You're the host.
Is it fine, ma'am?
Yeah, just I will try it. Yeah.
Okay. Right. So now we
okay. It's okay.
Good.
Yeah. Shall we start?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
Participants are 279. I think that is more than sufficient.
Finally.
279 participants are there. So we will start the topic, sepsis in dogs is actually a practical case for vets.
Madam, you mute on.
Hello.
You are not muted on.
Yeah. So let me start the topic of interest today. The sepsis in dogs, a practical tips for veterinarians. I've already told about the introduction of sepsis in dogs. It's a very common problem in dogs. And we get day-to-day practice, a lot of cases related to sepsis, probably in the stage of early sepsis or late sepsis or in the stage of septic shock or sometimes a multi-organ failure. Okay. Sepsis. Is it dangerous? Yeah, definitely. Sepsis is potentially a life-threatening condition caused by dysregulated host response to an infection. If there is an infection, if it gets dysregulated, as long as it is getting regulated and going on in the right pathway, it can come out of the infection. But of course, if it is dysregulated, then it is going to cause an erratic or uncontrolled disseminated inflammation. So this is what is going to happen. Okay, so coming to the different types of infection that happens in the body. So we have local infection versus systemic infection. So local infection is that we have a local, say, wound. It gets cleared off with a local inflammatory reaction with the redness, with the color, with the rubor, or with the inflammation in a particular site, it gets improved. Hello. Yes. Yeah, it clears off with a local inflammatory reaction. Okay.
ma'am, you unmute to all.
Yeah,
because lot of disturbances there.
Yeah, lot of disturbances there because newly participants are also coming. New talk. Yeah, I done it. Okay. Is it okay? So local infection versus systemic infection. You can see that local infection becomes all right and clears off with a local inflammatory reaction. Okay, and the systemic infection is so serious, sometimes it can release some cytokines and it can cause a devastating effects on the body system, and sometimes it can cause death also. So first thing is, you should know that systemic infection with the release of cytokines, how we can diagnose and all that. Coming to the next slide. So small animal sepsis. So the epidemiology of sepsis is poorly described in dogs and cats. Till now, in the whole of the world, we don't have a proper epidemiology of sepsis in dogs and cats, and it's but appears to be a major cause of mortality in hospitalized dogs and cats. And in India, we don't have any systematic study on sepsis. Very recently, they have started some studies on sepsis in animals, and it's almost in a primitive stage. Probably, a lot of work needs to be done on sepsis in dogs. Okay. It's all been the systemic inflammatory reaction in the body. It's been done by the effect of cytokines. These are the major cause for sepsis in animals or in any human being also. Is it good or bad? Cytokines are usually being released in the body when there is an inciting cause by an infectious agent. So this infectious agent has got in it a small molecular protein. We call it as a pathogen-associated molecular pattern. We call it as the lipopolysaccharide capsule. For example, it's a lipopolysaccharide capsule of the gram-negative bacteria. Okay, when it is being present in the infectious agent, and when the infectious agent enters inside, it is being recognized by the host receptors. Once it is being recognized, this cellular structures in the body, mainly the macrophages and the monocytes, is going to release some signaling proteins, very small molecular signaling proteins. We call it as the cytokine. These cytokines are being released from the body system, which is going to initiate an immune response. This immune response could be a humoral and otherwise cell-mediated immunity, or both mediated immunities will have action on the body system. There will be optimum cytokine signaling which eliminates the pathogen. This is how in any body system, even COVID-19 patients, we are seeing a lot of patients nowadays who they are very many patients are asymptomatic. This is mainly because if there is an optimum release of the pro-inflammatory cytokines and anti-inflammatory cytokines, and the signaling is quite normal. If you can get a very optimum signaling of the cytokines, then it is going to eliminate the pathogens, which is also not noticed in the patients. We don't find a clinical setup in the animals also. We don't find any clinical infection in the animals. We don't find any signs in the animals. Okay, but otherwise, so let's see when the cytokines sometimes becomes erratic also. So what is the physiological response to an infection? Once the infection comes inside, as I already told you, that there will be release of cytokines. These cytokines can be a pro-inflammatory cytokine or anti-inflammatory cytokine. These pro-inflammatory cytokines, mainly the interleukin-1 beta, TNF-alpha, interleukin-6. So these are the most important pro-inflammatory cytokines. And these are going to promote the inflammation. The other one is the anti-inflammatory cytokines, the interleukin-4, interleukin-8, and interleukin-10. So these are the anti-inflammatory. Suppose there is an optimal level of these two cytokines, pro-inflammatory and anti-inflammatory cytokines, because the signaling proteins, the chemicals released from the body system, then there's going to be a balance in the body system, which is going to result in the tissue recovery. This is going to cause a tissue recovery. Okay. So whenever there is a dysregulated response, say for example, if the system gets dysregulated, so what is going to happen? Dysregulated system response. See, we find a pro-inflammatory cytokine becoming very high in this particular case. So if you find a pro-inflammatory cytokine severely or excessively secreted, the most important cytokine, as I already told you, is the TNF.
Excuse me, ma'am.
Yes.
Ma'am, screen is not visible, ma'am.
Why
yes.
Is this,
So many people. Yeah, it's visible. Please write
ma'am, down. It's visible. Ma'am, it is visible. Ma'am, visible.
Yeah, okay. So we have the pro-inflammatory cytokine, which is the most important one, being the TNF alpha and the interleukin 1 beta. These are the most important pro-inflammatory cytokines, which is going to cause an uncontrolled inflammation if it is going to be excessively secreted or released. We can call it as a release, not a secretion, it's a release from the body. It is going to cause.
Ma'am, screen is not visible.
It's not visible?
No.
We can see the screen.
Yes.
Ma'am, it is visible.
Please don't describe to anybody.
Okay. So whenever we find an anti-inflammatory cytokine is decreased and pro-inflammatory is going to be increased, then it is going to cause a dysregulated response in the system, which is going to cause a devastating effect in the body system. Okay, next slide. So when this dysregulated body system, dysregulation of this response by the cytokines, which we call it as the cytokine storm. This is well appreciated even with our now pandemic COVID-19. In some patients, we find a maladaptive cytokine release, which is by the excessive release of TNF alpha and interleukin 1 beta. This is going to cause the release of this response to this unusual response to the cytokines. We call it as a systemic inflammatory response syndrome, which is going to cause a devastating effects on various body systems. So this body's response is out of balance and it is going to cause a multiple organ dysfunction in the body. Many systems get affected, mainly all because of the response or the dysregulated response from the body. Okay, that we call it as a dysregulated cytokine being released. We call it as a cytokine storm. Next slide. Go to the next slide. So this is a very pictorial representation of how organized traffic and dysregulated or disorganized traffic. You have a traffic route. You're coming outside from the home. That means you're getting some infection. The road, your body, and the traffic rules or the system, how it is going to react to the infection. If it is going to be a regulated traffic, you will reach the destiny. Okay, but if it is dysregulated, you have an erratic release, because every person to person it varies. Even you can get an example of this COVID, you know, this pandemic COVID. Some people react so badly, some people react in a very reasonable fashion, and we don't find any reaction in the body system or don't find any clinical signs. We call it as the regulated or dysregulated. Dysregulated, you can see this will end up with the accidents and end up with chaos. So you don't find to reach the destiny, that means you will not come out of the infection. You will get into severe forms of infection. So this is a pictorial representation of how the cytokines are going to cause a devastating effect. It's not the infectious agent. It is the body, how it is going to respond. If the response is good, okay, it's fine. If the response is bad, then we call it as a dysregulated response, which we call it as a cytokine storm. Next, this cytokine storm. What are the effects of the cytokine excessively released? I already told you there are pro-inflammatory cytokines and anti-inflammatory cytokines. Pro-inflammatory should not be excessively secreted or either of these. If it is nominal, it is fine. Otherwise, it is going to cause a severe lung injury. This lung injury, we term it as acute lung injury or acute respiratory distress syndrome. And most of the death due to sepsis is mainly because of the lung injury. And next is the renal failure also, and failure to the liver, and resulting in shock. This shock is mainly because of the extravasation of fluid from the vascular space into the extracellular space. So the vascular thing becomes shrunken, and there is no perfusion of the blood, which results in a poor perfusion, poor capillary filling, and poor peripheral defect in the body circulation, resulting in shock. This will result in organ failure and severe forms of sepsis, which we call it as a septic shock, and sometimes death in an animal. So, if the patient is being diagnosed at the right stage, we can go in for a recovery. Or if it is being delayed, it may result in death. Next slide. Okay, this is our most important slide. Is only the bacteria the cause for sepsis? Definitely not. Many people have an idea that only the bacteria cause the sepsis. It's definitely not. It's all the bacteria, the gram positive and the gram negative bacteria. The gram positive bacteria being most importantly Staphylococcus aureus, Staphylococcus aureus, and many bacteria, Streptococcus, and all those things. And gram negative is the most important gram negative bacteria being the coliforms, mainly the E. coli, the Proteus, and all those things. Viruses, you know very well now, the pandemic is also causing very severe sepsis. It's mainly because of the pathogen response, the pathogen that is being a pathogen associated molecular pattern that's been released, that's been present in the viruses is going to cause severe immune response in the body system. So even viruses can cause the sepsis. Mm-hmm. Even rickettsia, even now the ehrlichia is being categorized under the bacteria. Of course, it's also been classified under rickettsia. So ehrlichia can also cause sepsis, leptospiras, protozoans. The most important protozoa of canine importance or small animal practice in dogs is mainly the Babesia gibsoni and Babesia gate. And also the fungi can cause sepsis. So on total, what I want to tell you is that the bacteria as well as other organisms are also in capable of causing sepsis because of the signaling protein which is being released because of the presence of the pathogen associated molecular pattern, which we call it as the lipopolysaccharide capsule of the gram negative bacteria and such things like that. Coming to the sepsis associated diseases, the most common sepsis associated diseases in dogs is the bacterial enteritis, mainly caused by Salmonella and E. coli. So what happens is naturally we find, you can ask how it could cause and all that, but usually bacteria are present in the gut. But when there is any damage to the intestinal barrier, this bacteria can translocate from the intestine into the bloodstream and causes a systemic reaction. That is how this can cause sepsis in dogs. And next is parvoviral enteritis, a most common cause for sepsis in dogs. Next is urinary tract infection. Mainly the cystitis can also cause sepsis in dogs. This cystitis or erythritis or lower urinary tract infection or upper urinary tract infection or in general, urinary tract infection in general can cause the sepsis. Pyometra in bitches, the most common cause for sepsis in dogs. Is Pyometra in bitches. Canine ehrlichiosis, canine babesiosis caused by Babesia gibsoni, Babesia canis, leptospirosis, and post-surgical peritonitis. These are all the major causes for sepsis in dogs. When you find such cases, you should also think about whether the patient is in the early stage or in the late stage or in a very delayed fashion. And this post-surgical peritonitis is usually complicated with this abdominal surgeries only. If it is not being done with the aseptic surgery, it can result in post-surgical peritonitis also. And less common causes for sepsis in dogs is pyelonephritis, pneumonia, pyothorax, septic meningitis, septic arthritis, septic prostatitis, deep pyoderma, vasculitis, bite wounds, osteomyelitis, bacterial endocarditis. Okay, all these are the less common causes. We don't very commonly see sepsis in these animals. And next, the practical thumb rule. Okay, how to diagnose? I could hear some lot of noise. I don't know why. There is a lot of noise. Temperature. So the most important is the practical thumb rule, how to diagnose sepsis in dogs. So the vital signs are very important. Our veterinarians, many a times we fail to do all these investigations. Because why, in human practice, the is being done by the nurses, but here every work has to be done by the veterinarian. All the vital parameters has to be done by the veterinarian. So it is very difficult choices. All the patients with all these parameters, it's a little difficult. Okay. Yeah. So the most importantly, temperature. So we had to be very clear at what particular temperature we can say that it is abnormal. When the temperature of the animal indoors goes above 150.4 or less than 99 degree Fahrenheit, then we have to be a little cautious. The temperature goes below 99 or goes above 103.4. This is very important. This factor should be always be thorough with this, or we should memorize these particular points. Next is the heart rate. At any point of time, the heart rate should never go above 140 beats per minute. Respiratory rate should never go above 40 breaths per minute. Okay, these three vitals are very important, which can be based, which can be done based on the, your stethoscope. And you know, definitely we need to use a stethoscope. Many practitioners, we see that they don't want to use stethoscope. Just like that, they want to touch the animal and then start giving the treatment. And it is not an ideal practice. And next, once we find all these changes, getting we find some derangements in these, or say some deviations in these values, definitely we need to go for a blood checkup. And if we find WBC less than 5,000 cells per cubic millimeter, or WBC is more than 19,000 cells per cubic millimeter, then it gives a worry. It gives a signal that something is going erratic. Okay. Next is band cells. What are these band cells? These are the immature neutrophils found in the circulation. Many a times we count for 100 cells. We find band cells of more than 5, then it gives a signal, wrong signal, that the animal is having some sort of infection. And along with that, if you find a WBC count is also more, the mature neutrophil is also more, you know, then it gives a bad signal about the disease. Capillary refill time. How many of us check the capillary refilling time? Usually we don't do a capillary refilling time. We have to evert the upper mucosa, buccal mucosa, and then we have to give a pressure over that. If the refilling happens within 2 to 3 seconds, then it is normal. If it is getting delayed, say 10 seconds, or 8 seconds or 5 seconds, you know, then we say that it is having some disturbance. So these are the most important vitals. Your veterinarian should definitely make use of it for your diagnosis. Okay, so this vitals, temperature, heart rate, respiratory rate, and if there is any deviation, checking the WBC count is all that is very important. Next slide. Coming to the stages of sepsis. Coming to the stages, we classify the stage as sepsis early phase. You see this animal, it's in the early stage of sepsis. It's not having any problem. It appears like that it's not having any problem, but probably it's having a raised temperature, raised heart rate, or sometimes raised respiratory rate also. That's why it's now put under the early phase of sepsis. Then is the severe sepsis, which indicates that there is an organ dysfunction. If there is any organ dysfunction, for that matter, if the liver is dysfunction, or kidneys are dysfunction, or the lung is dysfunction, then we call it a severe sepsis. Multi-organ failure, if two or more organ systems are deranged, then we call it as a multi-organ failure. More than two organs, or two and more than two organs. Say kidneys and liver are affected, or kidneys and lungs are affected. Then we call it as a multi-organ failure. Then the last stage, the worst stage, it's called septic shock. In spite of your volume resuscitation, you give a lot of fluid, but in spite of that, the animal is going severely dehydrated or becoming very bad. You don't find any improvement. That's the first signal that the animal is in a state of septic shock. Okay, hope you follow this particular points on this different stages of sepsis. I'll go to the next step. Hyperdynamic phase. So once we identify, we say that the temperature and all that. If the temperature is very bad with the septic shock, then what are all the different forms of sepsis we can see? What are the different signs of sepsis? It is, one is a hyperdynamic phase of toxemia and the hypodynamic phase of toxemia. What is this hyperdynamic phase of toxemia? It's the early phase. It is actually a fighting phase. You can fight against the infection. Late phase, that's almost a septic shock. You cannot fight against an infection. It's almost going to die. That's a surrendering phase. So this is a fighting phase. This is a surrendering phase. What is this fighting phase and what are all the signs noticed? the animal will be slightly inhibited. It will not eat, it will choose it for certain foods. It all depressed, there is an increased rectal temperature, brick red mucosa, tachycardia, brick red mucosa. This is a very important finding, we call it as the injected mucosa. Injected, that is a very severely congested, is called as an injected mucosa. Tachycardia, bounding pulse, tachypnea, and CRT is less than 2 seconds. CRT, if you see, it will be less than 2 seconds. Then there's a hypodynamic phase. You see inhibitions here, you find anorexia. Totally the animal will not be eating, and almost it is in the rectal phase. Okay. So hypodynamic phase, you find anorexia. In this, you find inhibitions. And then in depressed behavior, you find an altered mental status. It's almost sometimes, it will show some sort of nervous signs also in these animals. And low temperature, wherein you find cold extremities of the dogs. And you find a pale to gray mucosa. These are all the important signs wherein we can find, okay, the animal is in the late stage of sepsis. You find, of course, tachycardia, but hypotension. That is the capillary refill time will be so much delayed, and there will be no perfusion of the blood, poor capillary perfusion, which results in the weak pulse, abnormal breath sounds, and CRT will be very much delayed. Sometimes we find associated with acute oliguria to anuria. The animal will not pass urine also. Okay, next slide. How to diagnose it? So, when you say that the animal is in voluntary state of sepsis, so what are the ways by which we can attempt for the diagnosis? The most important, the blood checkup, is a complete blood count, which includes a HB, PCB, RBC, WBC, thrombocyte count, and all these things. So this gives a very important clue for your diagnosis. Serum chemistry, of course, it includes the total protein, the albumin, the bun, the creatinine, the markers for the liver, that is SGPT or SGOT, GGT, ALP, all these things are very essential for finding if there is any organ damage. And most importantly, hemostatic parameters. If you find disseminated intravascular coagulation, that is a petechial and ecchymotic hemorrhages in the body, we can check for all these parameters like the prothrombin time, activated partial thromboplastin time, D-dimers, and fibrin degradation products. Certain steps are to be followed when the animal is suffering from severe blood leakage from the capillary, that we call it as the petechial or the ecchymotic hemorrhage. Then the other values that can be checked are the antithrombin and protein C, C-reactive protein, and the blood lactate levels. Of course, in India, we don't find much of the parameters that we are checking with all these things, because as I already told you that sepsis almost is in a primitive stage, and we don't go into a very wider section of diagnosis. Also, probably in the future, we may have to proceed including the C-reactive protein as well as the blood lactate level, which totally gets increased in almost many cases or the worst cases of sepsis. Next slide. Okay, with all this information that I have given, you know, what is sepsis? This is mainly because of the induction of the release of cytokines, the signaling proteins, which is causing a pro-inflammatory response, which is causing a cytokine storm and ending in a severe devastating effects called as a sepsis. If left untreated, can go for severe sepsis or septic shock or multiple organ dysfunction syndrome. So based on your idea, whatever I have told on sepsis, let's move on to the discussions of different cases which is been suffering from sepsis at different disease conditions. The first case is been presented here. You see the animal, it is almost recommend, almost in a little bad shape only. So this is a 5-year-old intact female spitz presents to TVCC on lateral recommendancy in Pondicherry. It was presented to the gynecology unit. The medicine unit can be transferred to the gynecology unit actually. Lateral recommendancy, anorexia, vomiting, temperature of 99 degree Fahrenheit, heart rate of 152 beats per minute, a respiratory rate of 44 breaths per minute, and distended and slightly tensed lower abdomen. So this is how the animal has been presented here, you can see that the temperature has gone down a little less and the heart rate is also a little low, high, more than 140 beats per minute, and the respiratory rate is also high, 44 breaths. Normally it should be 20 to 24 breaths per minute, but in this case 44 breaths is having tachycardia. So, and there is a distended and slightly tense lower abdomen also. Then we had gone for a blood investigation, which revealed that the hemoglobin was 10.2, PCV was 29.1, for almost normal only. But you can find the TLC count quite very high, 46,200 cells, which should definitely not go above 18,000 cells per cubic millimeter. But here you find 46,200 cells. A neutrophil segmented are 87, band cells are 4, lymphocytes are 9. And we find the bun 32 milligrams per deciliter, that's a blood urea nitrogen, and creatinine 1.2 milligram per deciliter. So this is what we find in this particular animal. So what is your diagnosis? Does the animal suffer from sepsis or severe sepsis? As long as it is only pyometra, it is only in the uterus, there is no problem. But this case is the early stage of sepsis, because almost all the parameters, the minimal parameters that we have checked, the temperature, the heart rate and the respiratory rate, all are in the higher temperature. Okay, so we can say that this is the early stage of sepsis. Then what disease do you suspect for? We suspect this animal for pyometra because we find a slightly distended or tensed lower abdomen. So we think of pyometra initially because it's an intact female. It's an intact female and is being presented like this with a low temperature. So the first important thing in an intact animal, which is not well given one, we can suspect for pyometra. And what is the plan for the further diagnostic technique? We will further move in for ultrasound or for radiography. Okay. For how well the condition can be managed, we need to go for panhysterectomy. This particular case, because you know very well that pyometra cases wherein there is a pus accumulation because of the hormone imbalances, accumulation of pus happens and it will be triggered by the inflammatory response mainly by the E. coli. And this E. coli translocates from the uterus into the blood, or sometimes the toxins released by the E. coli. Okay, this gets released inside the bloodstream. It diffuses inside the blood and it is going to cause sometimes the devastating effects also. So in this particular condition, we are suspecting for pyometra. So it has been transferred, the case has been transferred to. So the case has been transferred to gynecology section of the Pondicherry Veterinary College Clinical Department. So it has gone there and we could find that we find the uterus, which is slightly distended, with the see that there is some accumulation in the uterus also. So the next step is we need to go in for panhysterectomy. So pyometra case, the most way by which we can remove the infection is removing the foci of infection in the animal. It's mainly by the panhysterectomy. So panhysterectomy is the best way by which you remove the foci of infection, because if you keep on treating it, it's not going to get solved. So the best way for pyometra cases is to remove the foci of infection by doing panhysterectomy technique. So this is a photograph which I have got it from the gynecology unit. So next case has been presented here. So this is a Labrador dog. It's very difficult sitting. You can see the sitting posture also. So this case, a 5-year-old female Labrador presents with a polakiuria and stranguria. What is this polakiuria means? Because this is a history that's been given by the owner. Polakiuria means it is a frequent passage of urine. When the animal frequently passes urine, we call it as polakiuria. Very little, it passes urine frequently. In a day, almost around 10 to 20 times, it may be passing urine. And next is stranguria, that is difficult passage of urine, finding it difficult in the passage of urine. So these are the two important signs that we could get from the history from the owner. because every time when it comes to the hospital, it may not urinate also, but it tries to urinate, but will not be in a position to observe the animal also. So this is mainly the history that's been obtained from the animal, and we could check the temperature of 40.2 degrees centigrade with a heart rate of 94 beats per minute, and with a respiratory rate of 34 breaths per minute, and TLC count, we could see 27,000 cells per cubic millimeter. As I already told you that definitely the WBC count or the TLC count should not exceed 18,000 or 19,000 cells per cubic millimeter. In this particular case, we could find 27,000 cells. But the neutrophil count, the TLC, that's the differential leukocyte count, and the neutrophil 85%, lymphocytes 11%, monocytes 1%, and Bang cells are 3. And of the urine analysis, because it's finding difficulty in passing urine, we could collect the urine and we check the pus cells being 3+. The bun is almost 57 milligram per deciliter, and the creatinine is 1.8 milligram per deciliter. Definitely, we should know the normal values of the bun and the creatinine. Bun value should definitely not exceed at the highest level 40 milligram per deciliter. But the normal value is 8 to 28 milligram. But at any point of time, it should not exceed 40 milligram per deciliter. And the creatinine, the normal value is 0.5 to 1.4 milligram per deciliter. In this case, we could find that the creatinine values have increased to 1.8 milligram per deciliter. So these are all the investigations which we could obtain from the animal. So temperature is high, as well TLC is high, as well the urine analysis, we could find pus cells, bun and creatinine is high. Okay, so does the case suffer from sepsis? Definitely this animal is suffering from sepsis because we could find alteration in the temperature as well as in the blood picture. So it is the early stage of sepsis. Why it has happened? Why the sepsis has happened? Because this is localized only in the bladder and in the urethra. But this organism, the most important organism being the E. coli, favoring in the urinary tract of animals, especially the dog, it sometimes goes inside, or the toxin gets released inside the bloodstream, or sometimes the bacteria translocates from the bladder into the bloodstream, causing an early stage of sepsis. What is your diagnosis? This has been diagnosed as UTI because with the polarchiuria and strangulia with the pus cells and the blood picture, we diagnose this particular case as cystitis or urethritis. What is the test for diagnostic confirmation? It is mainly the urine culture and the antibiotic. Of course, we can go in for the ultrasound picture also. We will find a tensed bladder. We find the bladder wall thickness more than 3 millimeter. When you find such a changes, you know, we can say that the bladder wall thickness is there, and we can confirm it that it's a case of a bladder infection, which you call it as a cystitis. Now, what is the treatment plan? The best treatment, because we have made a study in Pondicherry Veterinary College also, we find that enrofloxacin seems to be the best drug when we give it. So enrofloxacin seems to be the best drug. The dose of 10 milligram per kg per day for 10 to 14 days, and you can use a urinary alkalizer. This is going to change the molality of the urine. It is going to make it little alkaline so that organisms will not multiply. And the best urinary alkalizer seems to be the Citralca, potassium citrate, which is available in the market. Nephrotec tablets has been available with Himalaya. And we can go for meloxicam, which is an NSAID. We can give it for 5 days to reduce the inflammatory tone. That is a lot of SIRS. Systemic inflammatory mediators released here. So to stop the release of these mediators, we can use meloxicam as well as the oral antacids, pantoprazole if necessary. So this is the most important one that we can try for treating the sepsis patient related to cystitis and urethritis.
Citralca.
Yeah, Citralca is a potassium citrate liquid which is available in the market, which will alkalize the urine so that these organisms will not multiply on the site. And we can somehow control the infection along with the antibiotics and along with this NSAIDs, the meloxicam. And meloxicam is also available orally. Oral tablets are also available. So that also we can try it. Next slide. So this is another important case. So this animal is a Rottweiler, a Rottweiler puppy of 3 months age. We can find an injected mucosa. Why is that? There is an, you can see that there is an injected mucosa in these animals. The Rottweilers, we can find an injected mucosa. And we don't find any other alterations. Funny thing is the animal is recommend. The animal is recommend with a break red mucosa. So what is the case? Whenever we find Rottweiler not vaccinated, the vaccination is not perfectly be done, we can think of
please mute all the participants na, it is in your hands.
Yeah.
Or remove those individuals who are causing disturbance continuously na.
Okay, so sepsis, so when you find a Rottweiler patient, you know, so this is a Rottweiler with an injected mucosa.
Ma'am, please, can you mute all the participants, ma'am, once again, ma'am, please. There's a lot of, you know, they're making a lot of noise, ma'am, in between.
Okay, so I muted it. So this is a particular case with the Rottweiler with the injected mucosa. We could find the mucosa in this animal. There's the only sign I noticed in this, but it's not been immunized. You see, no immunization against infectious diseases. So sepsis usually occurs with parvoviral enteritis. You should be very sure that sepsis can occur with parvoviral enteritis, mainly because this parvovirus, it affects the crypts of the villi. It is going to cause damage to the intestinal barrier. There is disruption of the intestinal barrier, which is going to cause bacterial translocation from the intestine into the blood. So this intestinal organisms, mainly the E. coli or the Pseudomonas or the Salmonella or the Clostridium, any of these organisms, it is going to translocate from the intestine into the bloodstream, which is going to induce the systemic inflammatory response syndrome with an increased release of TNF-alpha. You could find that this particular two breeds are very commonly affected with parvoviral enteritis. Usually all the dogs get affected with parvoviral, but when these two dogs get affected with parvoviral enteritis, then we should be very sure that the animal can anytime go in for sepsis, because this TNF alpha production is very high in these two breeds. So we have to be very careful when you are handling a patient of Rottweiler or a Doberman which is not immunized, and when they show signs of parvoviral enteritis, your usual supportive therapy probably sometimes may not work and may result in sepsis, mainly because of the increased release of TNF-alpha. Okay, next slide. So what is the usual supportive therapy that's been given for parvoviral enteritis? Usually the crystalloids and the colloids are the usual therapy that's been tried for the parvoviral enteritis, and the dose depends on the severity of the animal. Usually what we choose is the Regus lactate, which is an ideal solution because it contains potassium, calcium, lactate, and all the other essential electrolytes, that is the sodium and chloride. Along with that, we can use little amount of DNS. And the animal is very severely disturbed with severe problems of not severely dehydrated, you know. Then we can go in for Hetastat also. We can go for Hetastat, which is a colloid solution, which can be added after we choose this the Regus lactate and the DNS. After crystalloids, we can choose Hetastat also. I will tell you the dosage, how much has to be given. And the systemic antibiotics is imperative. Usually, based on your past experience, we can choose antibiotics for the parvoviral enteritis case. So what are all the antibiotics that have been tried for parvoviral enteritis? We can try a combination of antibiotics like cefotaxime along with amikacin, or cefotaxime along with metronidazole, or we can choose cephalosporidine drugs, mainly ceftriaxone along with amikacin. Some two groups of drugs which is going to act on gram-positive and the gram-negative bacteria will have a very good effect with this antibiotics which is parovirus. And next is antiemetics. The most important antiemetic being ondansetron, which is over-the-counter used for veterinary practice. These are off-label preparations which is available in the market, and the available drug which is in the human preparation which is available, which is being used for the pet practice, is the ondansetron. This is another drug which is the meropitant, which is being marketed by Zoetis, which is only now available in US, is not available in India. This is a very good effective antiemetic. Probably in the recent we may be getting this particular drug in our market also. Okay. Next is the antacids. The most important antacids that can be used is the injectable pantoprazole and the ranitidine. And the blood transfusion is also very good if the PCV falls below 20%. If you want to make the survival of the animal, you know, blood transfusions also will be very good if the PCV falls below with a donor, with a good donor. We have to choose a donor and we can. What is the additional supportive care that can be done for parovirus enteritis? Convalescent serum. So convalescent serum, the animals which are improving for parovirus enteritis cases can be chosen, and we can collect the serum from these animals. We can give at the dosage of 1 to 2 mL per kg body. Suppose if the pup weighs around 10 kg, we can give around 20 ml of the serum from the affected animal which has been improving. But if it is very difficult, we can leave it also, because at the last stages we can try. But of course, it is not approved for our practice, day-to-day practice. And next is filgrastim, which is the human granulocyte colony stimulating factor, which we call it as a filgrastim. This is being tried whenever the levels of leukocytes goes very low. When the levels of leukocytes are going very low, then we can use choosing this filgrastim. But of course, it's very costly drug. You want to make survival of the animal, then of course we can use filgrastim also. There's another drug which can be tried for parovirus, because these drugs will give some additional benefit for these animals. That's called as a Tamiflu or Oseltamivir. Therapy. This is an antiviral compound. In the early stages of the disease, it can be tried, which is a neuraminidase inhibitor. This is 2 mg per kg per os every 12 hours for 5 days. This can be tried for 5 days, neuraminidase inhibitor. This is going to suppress the translocation of the bacteria from the gut into the bloodstream. That's the most important effect of this oseltamivir. That's a neuraminidase inhibitor, because this neuraminidase is present in the bacteria. And this is very essential for the penetration inside, deep inside the mucosa. So if we want to stop the penetration of inside the mucosa, we can choose this neuraminidase inhibitor. This is the Tamiflu, which can be given at the dosage of 2 mg per kg every 12 hours for 5. Next is procalamin. This is a drug which is a primary parenteral preparation, which is having amino acids, glycerin, and electrolytes. When the animal is going anorectic, not taking any food, you want to supply some energy as well as some amino acids and electrolytes, and this will be the best choice. But of course, this is also not been available in India. Anyway, I'll show a lot of pictures about it also. Next, when the animal is improving, you know, when the animal has improved on the 4th or 5th day, you need to choose enteral nutrition with some drug, with some food, which will not cause any damage to the intestinal barrier. For which tender coconut gives a surprisingly good result for the intestinal regeneration. So this has been tried in many places also. This has to be strained, and only the fluid can be given around some 2 to 3 teaspoons every half an hour. So this will have a best effect for intestinal regeneration. Okay, coming to this ParvoCure, there's one more drug which has been available in the market, which is the anti-parvovirus chicken antibodies. That's a heterogeneous immunoglobulin Y available in the market, which has been marketed by Sihil Pharma. We call it as a ParvoCure tablets. The cost of the tablet is 1,000 rupees per 5 tablets. You can give once daily up to 5 days. This is having a very good effect. Say this is all antibodies, you know, it's going to fight against the antigen. So in the early stages of the disease, this can be given so that it will fight against. So after, when it is getting delayed, you know, this will not have much effect. When you're suspecting parvovirus, definitely we can try this ParvoCure tablet. Coming to the drug, I told you that meropitant, which is not available in India, which has been marketed by Zoetis, This is the first FDA anti-emetic drug that's been available for dogs and cats. What about you are using, you know, on date? As on date, we are using a lot of drugs. But those drugs, of course, they're off-label preparations. They've been used only for human beings. This is the first FDA approved drug for dogs and cats. And next one, which I have told you, is the Tamiflu. This is the preparation which is available as a syrup-based 6 milligram per ml. This can be given at the dose rate of 2 milligram per kg per hour every 12 hours for 5 days. This is also should be given at the early stage. What I told you is that, you know, early stage, if you give, this will stop the translocation of the bacteria from the gut into the intestine. What is this going on? What is it doing? They are not on. Okay. Next is the filgrastim. As I told you that the filgrastim, when the levels of the leukocytes are going very low in paroviral entities, the most important pathognomonic feature in the laboratory finding in the paroviral enteritis is leukopenia. We find pan leukopenia. So when you find pan leukopenia, we can go in for the neurobogen, which is the filgrastim, which can be tried for giving to improve the granulocyte colony stimulating factor. So this is a granulocyte colony stimulating factor. This is going to cause a severe an increase in the. Why is that?
Ma'am, please disable the annotations, ma'am. So anyone cannot do annotation on the screen, ma'am.
Why is that they are doing like that?
Ma'am, I don't know. Like if you take that. Can you just disable it so no one can use annotation on the screen?
Annotations clearly have to clear your drawings. Yeah. Okay. Why is that it's like this? Okay, this is the procalamin which I have told you, which has got the amino acids, the glycerol, and the electrolytes, which can be given IV, you know. So this will promote the parenteral nutrition. Parenterally, the patients are very, very bad, you know. Then we can try with the amino acids, the glycerol, and the electrolytes. Next slide. This is the intralipid, which can also be tried for paroviral enteritis cases. This is 20% soybean oil, 1.2% egg yolk, 1.2% egg yolk with the phospholipids, glycerin and water for injection. And the dose rate is 2.5 ml per kg body weight. And it is available at the rate of 550 rupees per 100 ml bottle. This can also be tried at the, say for example, the dog is around 10 kg. You can give around 25 ml for that animal IV. So that it's going to supply the essential levels of the amino acids, the proteins, as well as the energy source for these animals. Okay, this is the immune booster, which is available in the market, which has been marketed by Echatrix company, Organic Private Limited. This is the immune booster. It is a free radical scavenger. All these peroxides will be scavenged by this immune booster preparation and is for the general well-being for dogs and cats. It contains dissolved oxygen, minerals, enzymes, and amino acids. And the dose in drops, it should be given on the first, say, for example, you take a week. First in 2 days, you give around one drop. 3 and 4, you give another one drop for small breaks. 5, 6, one drop, and day 7. So it's like that when you follow it, you know. It is going to be a free radical scavenger. It promotes competent immunity. That is compromised. If the patients are getting compromised, you know, to have a competent immunity, we can use the self-act immune booster for improving the immune status of the animal. Next is Megavac P nasal. This is also another vaccine that's been marketed by Indian Immunologicals. We have got a lot of vaccines available in the market by Intervet companies. There's a Vanguard we have got, and the MSD companies are marketing new vaccines. So apart from that, Indian Immunologicals are also having vaccines for parovirus. Now they have launched this Megavac P nasal vaccine for pets. and this can be instilled by the owners themselves, you know, inside the nostrils, so that it's going to have a protective immunity for the dogs which are around 4 to 6 weeks of old. So it's an intranasal vaccine containing live attenuated canine parvovirus grown in the cell culture. Okay, this is the next case of sepsis in animals. So we can find this leptospirosis in a Labrador dog, which is having a pale and a blanched mucosa. We can find a high color urine in this animal also. So this is a male Labrador aged 5 years, a presence with a history of anorexia, lethargy, bile vomiting 2 to 3 times a day, melena, litres, and high colored urine. So this is the finding in a Labrador. And further inquiry revealed that the dog has missed its annual vaccination against infectious disease. So this is a report that we have got from the animal. The WBC count is 42,000 cells per cubic millimeter. Neutrophils are 90, and the RBC count is 5.26, and hemoglobin is 12.5. Of course, this is having a poor perfusion. That's why the animal is showing a very blanched mucosa also. So this biochemical result showed bilirubin 7.82, bilirubin direct is 3.51, SGPT and SGOT are in the higher levels. We can find the alkaline phosphatase and the gamma glutamate transferase are also very high. We find protein total, which is very low, 4.49. So the normal value should be at least 6.5 grams per deciliter. We could find 4.49, albumin is 1.78, and globulin is 2.71. Blood urea nitrogen, if you see the blood urea nitrogen, it is 107.26, and creatinine is 6.56. So this is the animal which is showing such a picture in this investigation. Okay, so now what is your tentative diagnosis? So this particular animal is being suspected for leptospirosis because the animal has missed its annual vaccination. And does it have any organ involvement because of sepsis? Definitely yes. The two organs that are totally getting involved are the hepatic and the renal. Okay. And what is the gold standard test to confirm the result? Is the microscopic agglutination test. So microscopic agglutination test.
Sorry for interruption. Sorry, ma'am. Please mute all the participants again, ma'am.
Okay. So what is the tentative diagnosis? It is a leptospirosis because this is a case of almost severe sepsis. This animal is almost suffering from severe sepsis and with the organ involvement of liver and the kidneys. And the most important gold standard test to confirm the disease is the microscopic agglutination test. So this microscopic agglutination test was carried out laboratory of Madhavaram Milk Colony, the Leptospira unit in Chennai, and it was found seropositive for Leptospira australis with a titer value of 1:800. So this particular case is a case of severe sepsis caused by Leptospira australis because there are two organs got affected in this particular case. This next case, it's a Labrador. We can see a puffed up appearance of this animal, which is mainly because of the vascular leak. That's why we could find the extravasation of fluid from the blood capillaries inside the system, inside the extravascular space. And you can find that almost the body is puffed up. This is a black Labrador aged about 2 years and presented in a recumbent state with sudden onset of illness, anorexia, and breathing distress with history of acarias. That's a tick infestation. Temperature is 104 degree Fahrenheit, injected mucosa, 102 heart rate, respiratory rate is 40 per minute. What disease do you suspect? How do we proceed further? So this is a tick infested animal and these signs are very high. So immediately we should think of a tick-borne infectious disease. So this is a dog presented here. It's a Dalmatian puppy, aged about 3 months. It was presented with a history of not taking food and water, and it has developed petechial and ecchymotic hemorrhages in the ventral abdomen. Owner removed few ticks from the body. Now, how do we proceed further? So, this particular animal, this first animal, which I told you that's a Labrador, it was having a platelet count of 72,000 cells per cubic millimeter, and another puppy has got 43,000 cells per cubic millimeter. And the serum biochemistry value of creatinine of Labrador, I mean of the Labrador, is 3.3 milligram per deciliter. This puppy succumbed within 3 days. Succumbed that the animal died within 3 days, and the Labrador died within a month in spite of rigorous treatment. So we could find Babesia gibsoni in the blood smear of this animal. See the Babesia gibsoni, the parasitic load is too high. We can find the parasitic load, it's very high. So on the next Labrador, now this we have done a scanning of that animal, and we could find the spleen, which is quite bigger, the X-ray, the radiography. No, we can find a spleen which is very large in size. We can find a large spleen, and splenomegaly is the important finding of babesiosis syndrome. And of course, we have done a radiography also. We could find pulmonary edema. So pulmonary edema with infiltration, and you find a spleen which is very large in size. Okay. So I told you that both animals died in spite of treatment. Okay, we could see that we had gone for a postmortem of this Dalmatian dog, which had suffered from babesiosis. And we could find splenomegaly. You can see the spleen, which is very big in size. And this is an important case of sepsis, a severe form of sepsis, which you could find in this animal, and hepatomegaly with condition. Okay, and next slide. I'll show you the next slide. You can see the lung edema. You see the lung edema, it's so severe that the lung is totally affected with the acute lung injury and acute respiratory distress syndrome. And that's why the animal had collapsed in spite of treatment within 3 days. And we could find a hemorrhage of the epicardium also. Now coming to the treatment part of Babesia gibsoni. So Babesia gibsoni case is also capable of causing pathogen-associated molecular pattern, which can cause sepsis.
Lele, 48A.
So treatment of Babesia gibsoni. So what are all the ways by which we can treat Babesia gibsoni when it is going for sepsis? So the prescribed drug as for the international standards is the atropion with azithromycin. Atropion is being used at a dose rate of 10 milligram per kg every 8 hours. And azithromycin is used as 10 milligram per kg every.
Ma'am, please unmute to all.
Ma'am, please unmute to all.
Yeah. Okay. Atropion with azithromycin is a combination of drug which can be tried for Babesia gibsoni. And the next, because this atropion, it is not available in India. So the next drug that we can use is diminishing acetate and the combination of imidacarb, which can be given on the same day. So you see that the diminishing acetate can be used at the dose rate of 3.5 milligram per kg intramuscular, a single dose on the first day. After 1 hour, we can use this imidacarb at the dose rate of 6 milligram per kg. Subcutaneous or intramuscular. And next is after the first day, we can choose clindamycin on the subsequent days at the dose rate of 25 milligram per kg every 12 hours for next 10 days. This will give tremendous recovery against Babesia gibsoni, because single drug will not be useful for Babesia gibsoni patients. we need to use a combination of therapy to have a better effect. So this combination drugs, dimethicin, imidacarb and clindamycin, gives a tremendously good result with this particular agent. Next is bupivacaine and azithromycin. This has been tried in Kerala and areas like that. And the bupivacaine dosage is 5 mg per kg intramuscular every 48 hours, that is at the 48 hour interval, after 2 days. You know, you give another shot. And azithromycin 10 mg per kg per os every 24 hours for 10 days. So this is one sort of drug which can also be tried for babies. There gives an eye because there is no standard protocol that's been available for the treatment of babies. There gives an eye. Every region uses a different combination of drugs against babies. There gives an eye. And the next combination of drugs which has been tried is doxycycline at the dose rate of 5 mg per kg BID for 10 days. Clindamycin 25 mg per kg BID for 10 days and metronidazole also for 10 days. After if there is slight improvement, we can again continue for the next 10 days to completely recover from the baby's Gibson load in the toxin tanks. So this is one important disease which is of great importance for which practitioners find it very difficult, and it can promote sepsis in these animals. Also, next is sixth case. This is a spitz which has been presented with severe dullness and depressed and in a recommended state, and the temperature was 104 degree Fahrenheit with the alteration in the vital parameters. And it had showed a high colored urine also, almost blood colored urine. Okay, this particular case was diagnosed as Babesia canis. Of course, in Babesia canis, I would like to tell you one thing. There are three forms of Babesia present in the world. One is Babesia canis rosei, which is present in South Africa, which is a very, very detrimental pathogen, which causes severe sepsis or septic shock and causes immediate death. That is Babesia canis rosei, that is present in South Africa. Babesia canis, this is another pathogen present in European countries and in Japan. This is another pathogen called as a Babesia canis ogeli, that is present in India. So this can also promote sepsis if it is found in a very high load. You could find in this particular picture that there is a very severe parasitemia, lot of loading with this Babesia canis organism. That is the reason why we could have hemoglobinuria. Okay. So it is 104 degree Fahrenheit and you could find a high colored urine also. So what is the treatment for Babesia gibsoni? Sorry, Babesia canis. So the Babesia canis is a very easy treatment that can be done because it's a very big pathogen. Unlike the Babesia gibsoni, Babesia gibsoni is very small. It's very difficult to treat also. So in this, we can treat with dimethicin acetidate at the dose rate of 3.5 mg per kg intramuscular, or imidacarb 6.6 mg per kg intramuscular or subcutaneously. Either of these drugs, both are found to be very suitable for clearing a Babesia canis, which sometimes causes, not I don't say it always causes sepsis, but sometimes it can lead to sepsis if the virus load is too high, if the bacteria, protozoal load is too high, and it's going to release the cytokines in the body. And next, supportive drugs, we can give some iron tonics, and we can give with NSAIDs if the temperature goes very high. And if the platelet count is going very low, we can try with some preparations available in the market. That is a thrombophyt, which is going to improve the thrombocyte count also. Next case, this is being presented, the German Shepherd. When you when you see a German Shepherd, it has been presented like this with a severe bleeding from the nasal cavities. This is one particular dog, the case 7, dog 1, has been presented here like this. And next case is a German Shepherd dog. It's almost very dull and depressed. It's again a German Shepherd dog with the lymph nodes swollen. So this is one important case. which usually we get in your practice, a 2-year-old male German Shepherd dog with previous history of acariasis, that's a tick infestation, unilateral epistaxis, and lymphadenomegaly. A temperature of this animal is 39.7. Heart rate is 92 beats per minute. The respiratory rate is 33 breaths per minute. And WBC count, as I told you, it is very less. It is 2,850 cells per cubic millimeter. So we could find alterations definitely with the temperature, heart rate, and the WBC picture. Of course, in the DLC picture, we could find neutrophils 43, lymphocytes 53, and monocytes 4. And the platelet count is 46,000 cells per cubic millimeter. This particular study, you know, if you find a neutrophil count seriously less, normal neutrophil count for dogs is 60-70%. But in this case, we found 43% of neutrophils. Lymphocytes is 53% and monocytes is 4%. And platelet count should definitely be more than 1 lakh cells per cubic millimeter. In this case, we found 46,000 cells per cubic millimeter. So now, what is the disease that's being suspected here? Because when you find a neutrophil count, this is a retrospective study. You know, we have made a study in Pondicherry. Dr. Abhirami has done a study here, and she has done on almost around 2,000 cases. And she found consistently the reports of low levels of neutrophil and increased levels of lymphocytes in dogs suffering from chronic issues. So this is a case, interestingly, we find this particular alteration. If you find such an alteration, you know, you find that the animal is suffering from issues. Okay. So we find the BUN values of 96 milligram per deciliter and creatinine 4.2 milligram per deciliter. And total protein 7.5, albumin is 2.5 and globulin is 5. See, in this picture also we find globulin values are quite high when compared to the albumin, right? And there is also little high levels of total protein. So this is a very typical picture of chronic ehrlichiosis because of the elaboration of globulins. And we found BUN and creatinine also. So what is your tentative diagnosis? When you find German Shepherd breed, immediately we should think of ehrlichiosis, and we find this particular alteration in the picture of the DLC count. Usually with a cell counter, we are checking the DLC, but usually it is not so. This DLC picture should be counted manually, and we find this particular alteration with the presence of monocytes and the decline level of platelets. Definitely there is every chance for suspicion for canine monocytic ehrlichiosis. And there is also organ damage in this animal. We find a renal damage as well as coagulation defects because this PT, APTT, everything was also less in this particular case. And also because of the antiplatelet antibodies, there is a very drastic decline in the platelet count, which has produced the coagulation defects in this animal. What is the diagnostic test for confirmation? Of course, it's a PCR, which need to try for cases suffering from ehrlichiosis, because that's a gold standard test for diagnosis of ehrlichiosis. Now, what is the treatment plan that we can see? But usually, clinicians do a very good practice for the ehrlichia treatment. This is the standard treatment, doxycycline at the dose rate of 5 mg per kg, twice daily. We need to give morning and evening for 28 days. Okay, then we should start with glucocorticoids. If you find the alteration in the values of the blood picture, you know, we find an increased levels of globulin, then we can try using this prednisolone. Also, at the dose rate of 0.5 milligram per kg body weight per os, every other day, alternate days, we need to give prednisolone. Otherwise, it will cause some immune suppression also, if you're going to give it daily, and some other infections can supervene. And also, this is going to suppress the hypothalamo-pituitary adrenal axis suppression. That's why we need to give prednisolone. Initially, we can give daily, and later we need to give every other day, alternate days with prednisolone. Platelet activators should definitely be tried when the platelet levels are quite less. Blood supporters, if the blood values are quite less, we can try with Shimup or some activators which is going to promote the HP values. Oral antacids animal is vomiting, and all the most, no, apart from all these things, the tick control plays a major role for treating the alopecia patient, because on the 28th day, another viable tick carrying the infection is going to bite, you know, then naturally it is going to get an infection. So the tick control measure is very important for the treatment of alopecia in dogs. So this is a usual trial that's been tried among clinicians, but we have tried a trial with doxycycline and chloroquine. Chloroquine is also your equally effective drug in combination with doxycycline. When you give it for 21 days at the dose rate of 2.5 mg per kg in 3 divided doses, along with the doxycycline, it tremendously gives you good result, and it clears the pathogen from the body even in chronic cases of erythrosis. We found PCR negative even after 2 months. So this is, seems to be a quite combination drug which is found to be effective if you give it orally treatment for erythrosis. Okay, coming to the end of this chapter, the general points for severe sepsis to septic shock. So our topic of interest is the sepsis. You know, it can be in any stage. It can go to a stage of septic shock. So what is that? We have to do it. The most importantly, we should maintain the airway, breathing, circulation, and decrease. So airway is by giving, putting an endotracheal tube, and breathing is that if the breathing is not properly done by the lung, you need to go for external breathing devices. We need to go for oxygen support. And circulation definitely should be done with fluids, the intravenous fluids, the crystalloids and the colloids. And the ideal crystalloid for any type of shock is Ringer's lactate with a multiple electrolyte solution, 90 ml per kg intravenous. So when the animal is in a stage of septic shock, it's quite dangerous, and we need to go in for the high dosage of crystalloid and followed by colloids. Why are we using colloids in cases of septic shock? To expand the blood volume. This HETASTAT is a plasma volume expander, and this should be tried at the dose rate of 10 ml per kg intravenously. If you give after dosing with crystalloids, it is going to expand the fluid volume and improves the perfusion of blood to the periphery. If you are not doing with HETASTAT, naturally this will move into the extracellular space, and again the animal will become severely hypoperfused and hypotension will be prevailing in the animal. So main thing is airway, main is giving oxygen support and circulation. Blood transfusion is advised if any underlying causes is causing the lower levels of PCC, go in for blood transfusion. But what is the dosage of blood to be transfused? So there is a formula, desired PCV minus patient PCV by transfusion PCV into 90 into body weight. So that amount of ml should be collected from your donor and should be given. Okay, whenever the albumin levels are too low, hypoalbuminemia, it is going less than 1.5 gram per deciliter, we can choose canine-specific albumin. This is the human albumin because it's not available in the market. Canine-specific albumin is not available. Of course, we can choose the human albumin mixed with the normal saline and we can give it IV. Okay. Intravenous antibiotics. This is of the choice of the veterinarian. Usually what we have to do is we can combine antibiotics and we can treat a case of sepsis. Don't give only one particular antibiotic. Always choose antibiotics and do it. Antiemetics, ond and citron, are the dose rate of 0.5 mg per kg intravenously. The animal is severely vomiting. And anti-inflammatory drugs that we can try is meloxicam as well as flunixin meglumin. this anti-endotoxic drug, which can also be tried for patients with sepsis in dogs. Next, when the patient is severely hypotensive, that means the animal is almost comatose, in spite of your volume resuscitation, it is not improving at all. So your last choice should be the vasopressors. Vasopressors, they are the catecholamines, which is going to constrict the blood vessels and is going to increase the blood pressure in dogs which are critically ill. The vasopressors for septic shock, the best vasopressor that you can choose when compared to dopamine, you know, is a norepinephrine. It can be chosen at the dose rate of 0.2 to 3.3 micrograms as a continuous rate infusion. This can be done only in your hospital referral setup in your intensive care unit where you have all the facilities. Just like that, in a clinical ward, we cannot give norepinephrine intravenously. It has been mixed with normal saline or dextrose 5% or DNS and should be given slowly as a continuous rate infusion. And the last but not the least, the therapy finally to be used in septic patient is the glucocorticoids. Whenever everything fails, you know, then we can, the last resort we can try is the glucocorticoids. Glucocorticoids, the best glucocorticoid when compared to dexamethasone and betamethasone, when methylprednisone, is hydrocortisone. Hydrocortisone can be used at the dose rate based on the severity of 1 to 5 milligram per kg intravenously. So when you give it IV, when it is not improving with any other drug, on the last choice should be corticosteroids, glucocorticoids. And when there is a severe lung injury that you suspect, you know, with severe sepsis, when there is a severe breathing distress, of course, we can try with glucocorticoids. So this is the last slide of this presentation. Of course, a lot of confusions they have, people have made here. Anyway, I'm a little annoyed by that. And this is, with this, I will make a close to the case of sepsis in animals. If you have any queries, you know, you can just make, you can just speak to me. Before that, I would like to thank my dean, Dr. Ram Kumar, who had given me an opportunity to present on with the help of Dr. Ramamuthi sir. He is a wet life, the international web that he has started, WhatsApp group he has started. Dr. Ramamuthi sir, I sincerely thank Dr. Ramamuthi sir, Dr. Sanjeev Nehru, the organizing secretary for Sabha. And also a special thanks to Shri Mohit Kher Gupta. He is the chief executive officer for Atlantic Organic Private Limited. They are come out with the self-ed preparation, which is also extremely doing very well. And thanks to all organizers, I will thank my mentors, you know, Dr. Pratapan sir, Dr. S.R. Srinivasan sir, Dr. Nambi sir. Without them, I am not here actually. And I thank all the faculty of my department. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. If you have any queries, you can ask me.
Ma'am.
Yes.
Sir, मैं अब बोल रहा हूँ माँ. ये कैसी है?
कैसी मम्मी?
ये कैसी है?
पेट की डेली.
हाँ.
ये जड़ी गंदबंद आया था.
अच्छा.
दो दवाई हैं.
दवाई दे रहा हूँ माँ. दवाई.
हाँ. If you have any query, you can ask me.
चमचे का दिन पाऊँगी.
Ma'am, can you show me the annotations, ma'am? Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, everybody. Thank you, everybody.
Ma'am, thank you so much, ma'am. Especially, ma'am, Dr. Vijayalakshmi, ma'am. Head Department of Veterinary Medicine. Once again, I just want to just introduce you once again. She's Rajiv Gandhi Institute of Veterinary Education and Research, Pondicherry. Yes, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Yeah, thank you.
It was very helpful. Yes. Ma'am, if you allow me, ma'am, before this question, question and answer session, ma'am, can I run my before the...
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. If you have any queries, you can just ask me.
Ma'am, I'm just...
Hello, ma'am.
Hello, ma'am.
Just sending the message. Yes, just sending the message. We will.
Dear host, before starting, you better mute everyone so that it will be soundless.
Concentrated liquid, Selfed is a super energized mineral and nutritional supplement which you can add to the drinking water of your pet on a daily basis. Selfed is a registered blend of natural plant sourced minerals, and so it contains no alcohol and no glucose. It is an absolute organic product. As Selfed is highly concentrated, so it is recommended with very low dosing, as prescribed in the brochure. Selfed is not a medicine, so it is not intended to treat, cure, or prevent any disease. It does not have any side effects, yet it has numerous benefits, and you can give it to not just dogs, but even to cats too. There are four different categories of Selfed that you can give to your dogs and cats. First, Selfed General Well-being. It enhances the vitality and the energy of your pet. It also enhances the texture and feel of the coat of your animal. It also helps in the urinary function and also the detoxifying function when the liver is fighting with other diseases. Selfed Female. It provides vitality and nutrition during pregnancy and during lactation. It provides additional calcium to the lactating bitches. Selfed Immune Booster. It takes care of the immunity-related diseases of your pets, and it also increases the vitality of the immune system, especially after taking the antibiotics. Selfed Junior. It is suitable for all puppies and kittens from 7 weeks onwards. It supports the skeletal development during early years. It improves digestion, and it also reduces the unbalanced hyperactivity of all the puppies.
Hello.
Yeah, I'm running my other video. Cellodyne.
Thank you, Jashmi.
Yes, no,
I'm running my other video, sir. It's a Cellodyne antiseptic solution. It's a 1 minute video, sir. Just a minute. So it's starting to get a little bit.